My brothers and sisters, today is the third Sunday after Pentecost. The readings appointed for the day are from Proper 7, Track 1. They are Genesis 21, verse 8 to 21, Psalm 86, 1 to 10 and 16 to 17, Romans chapter 6, verse 1 through 11, and St. Matthew chapter 10, verse 24 through to verse 39. I will pray the collect for the day, after which I'll read the gospel appointed for today. This will be followed by a meditation from Father Garfield, and we will close with the hymn, Beauty for Brokenness, by Graham Kendrick. Let us pray. O Lord, make us have perpetual love and reverence for your holy name, for you never fail to help and govern those whom you have set upon the sure foundation of your loving kindness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A reading from the Gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 10, beginning at verse 24. Jesus said to the 12 disciples, "A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are more valuable than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do you think that I come to bring peace to the earth? I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against his mother, and a daughter-in-law against a mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's household. Whoever loves father and mother more than me are not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Word of God, written in Genesis chapter 21, reading from verse 15 through 19. When the water in the skin was gone, Hagar cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bowshot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of my child." And as she sat opposite the child, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened Hagar's eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. In this passage for our meditation, it is set in the wider context of Genesis chapter 21. And in this passage, we find a horrid tale of Hagar and her son Ishmael being rendered non-entities by Abraham and Sarah, who were people with power and privilege. But even as they rendered Hagar and Ishmael as such non-entities, Hagar and Ishmael were seen significant in the sight of God. In the text, we see God coming to the aid of this enslaved and dispossessed woman and her bastard child. God rescued them from the injustice that was meted out to them by those who were their masters. God delivered them from the barrenness of the wilderness into which they were cast, left for dead. God lifted them from the clutches of death to which they were sentenced by the powerful. The casting out of Hagar and her son was as a result of Sarah's fear of losing her pride of place and her wealth. So the desire to protect wealth led her to hate and despise Hagar and Ishmael. But Sarah was not the only one who abused her power in dealing with Hagar, for her husband's abdication of his responsibility to protect this powerless woman and his child led to the exploitation in the first place. Abraham went along with the trampling of the humanity of Hagar without standing up to Sarah, who was the instigator of the exploitation. I know it is hard for us to hear these passages in the light that I have framed it, because after all, God chose Abraham and Sarah. They were there to bring forth a people that would be agents of reconciling the world to God. They, in the annals of the faith, are righteous people. And while that might be true, even so-called righteous people can do unjust things. In the wider scheme of the Judeo-Christian narrative, Abraham and Sarah are indeed foreparents of a holy people, but it does not make the act that they committed against Hagar and Ishmael any less atrocious and abhorrent. What we see more than anything else in this passage being displayed by Abraham and Sarah is that human beings are not immune to being agents of discrimination, oppression, and injustice. God is the one who opposes such things, and God lifts up those who are faced with oppression and tyranny. So when Sarah and Abraham became forces of oppression for the dispossessed, Hagar and Ishmael, God stepped in and God lifted them up. This passage from Genesis, more than anything else, is about God's action, about God's compassionate care and concern for people who are poor, marginalized, and oppressed. And we see the same kind of action in Jesus the Christ, who is always reaching out to the poor. He's always standing with those on the margins of society. He's always showing compassion for the powerless, to those who are cast out, and to those who are voiceless. And in so doing, Jesus would bring those on the outside in the loving embrace of God. Even when the establishment and those with power and privilege opposed him. And that is an indication to us who are and who wish to be followers of Jesus the Christ, that we must become people who, like God in Jesus Christ, stands on the side of the poor and the oppressed. And if we, who call upon the name of the Lord and invoke the power of God, stand with the poor, then we will create a world that is more just, a world that is more equitable. A world where people are less worried about personal possessions and give more credence to the common good. Because that is what God demands of us. And until we create that world, then there will continue to be strife and mayhem and chaos. Because each of us are called to become the keepers of our brother and our sister. We are here to help each other, to bear each other's burdens, to walk with each other, to share with each other. We are not here to oppress. We are not here to dispossess. We are not here to abuse. But we are here to show care and compassion. And I pray that each of us will find it in our hearts to reach out to one person who is less fortunate and seek to make that one life better. And we will change the world one by one. Amen. For reflection, take a moment to reflect on whether in your daily life you neglect and mistreat the poor and the oppressed. Reflect on what ways you can contribute to making someone else's life easier. Think of ways in which you can help to end cycles of discrimination and exploitation of others. Let us pray. O God of the poor, friend of the weak, give us compassion, we pray. Melt our cold hearts so that we might repent of our evil ways. Come, Lord, change our love from a spark to a flame, so that we may follow the example of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to care for the poor, the oppressed, and the marginalized. This I pray through Him who loves us beyond all measure, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.